Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, worship leaders, media, sound system. Thank you. Let's give a welcome to the visitors. While everyone is, you may have a seat. While everyone is getting situated, I have a few things. I'm going to need help with this table. Okay. And be very careful. This part, if you would hold right here. And it's heavy. Thank you very much. Yes. Okay. Thank you. So. On February 20th of this year, the Lord gave me a vision. And I didn't quite understand it. So this is how it happened. There was a large, huge stone standing upright with all of its strength and beauty. All of a sudden, a piece of stone broke off and fell to the ground. And it broke into more pieces. And it broke into dust. I didn't understand it, but I knew the stone, the huge stone, was significant. Then again, the Lord showed me the huge stone with all of its strength and beauty. And again, the piece fell off. Small pieces. Dust. I asked the Lord, what does this mean? I don't understand it. Once again, the huge stone. With all of its strength and beauty. And took pieces. And dust. Except this time, some of the dust blew away. I will vacuum. I waited on the Lord. I waited for his answer. In the meantime, I picked up the small stones. And there were thin, lying cracks. And I thought, at any moment, more pieces could break. Then God answered. Here is God's revelation. Remember, when he gives a vision, it's his vision, not ours. When he gives the revelation, it's his revelation, not ours. The Lord said, the huge stone represents the church, God's people. And they have all of God's strength. It comes from him. And the beauty of it all is that they hear God's voice, spreading his word, and his word is flourishing. The piece of stone represents circumstances that broke off of the stone and into smaller pieces. The dust represents crushed hearts, and the dust that blew away represents those absent from the church, from the body of Christ. So I asked the Lord, I know you know our church. You know each and every one of us. You know our heart. You know our mind. You know us day by day, even when we sleep. And so he's saying to us, he knows us. Say to your neighbor, God knows. And again, God knows. And say to yourself, God knows me. Again, say it with joy and confidence. God knows me. God knows me from beginning to end. He knows our life. He knows what we've been through. He knows what's coming. And yet, we are his joy and pride. The Lord also wants you to know that most of us think we can put him in a box. We say yes to this and no to that, and yet he's in the box because we keep him there only for our convenience. But he says it's the other way around. You've put yourself in a box and you limit yourself. God knows me. Say to yourself, God knows me. Does God know you? Does God know you from beginning to end? God knows you. God knows your mind. And again, he will walk with you and he's with you. He knows when things happen in life. And he's right there with you. He knows your grievances. He knows your sadness. He knows excitement when you receive good news. He loves you and he respects you. He respects your decisions when you answer him. There's so much work to do. There's so much work. The title of the message is The Stone. The subtitle is The House of God. Let's turn to 1 Peter 2, 4, verses 4 through 5, and I'm going to read from the NIV version. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ, his Son, his precious Son. We are his children. We are his sons and daughters. We are precious in his eyes. Jesus is the living stone, the source of life. We go to him, we seek him, and he's always a reminder of who he is in our lives. We are the living stones, the believers, being built by God's word, one stone at a time, one word at a time. And we will always be under construction until he calls us home. To be a holy priesthood is learning and using God's power and the authority that he's given us in the name of Jesus Christ through every life situation, every circumstance, large or small. We are to learn to stand firm on his word. And we do. Sometimes we do, but it can get a little rocky at times. We think we're okay when we're not. We say we're okay to others when we are not. And yet, God knows. He hears every response when someone comes to you and say, how are you? How are you doing? He hears that response. this morning in Sunday morning education, Pastor Henley mentioned something, and she said, we cannot deceive God. Even in when he knows, we can't. There is no way that you can deceive God. He will bring it back to remembrance, what we did, what we said, but in actuality, he wants to save us, redeem us, heal us, restore us. All he wants is the best for us. But we have to remember who he is. He's the God of all gods. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He will never forsake you. Our spiritual sacrifice is living life pleasing to the Lord by learning his word and applying it to our life. That's your spiritual sacrifice, because we are trying our best, striving as unto the Lord. Again, say, God knows. God knows me. He comforts us, and he restores our strength. He renews it as he restores your heart, your mind, and your body. All for his honor and glory. He will never leave you behind, although we sometimes have to catch up with him, right? Because what he told you yesterday, and if we didn't do it, he'll remind us and bring us up to speed to do these things. We have to learn his way, because people are watching, the nation is watching. And he says to you and I, we have so much work to do. Yes, happens, things happen in life, happenings, events, some so that we just can't talk about it at times, some that are, we want to be alone, and some things that we're glad to share with someone so they can help us. God knows. He goes after the one that is absent from the body of Christ. Didn't he go after you? He came after me. He chased me. Did he chase you? We all have a response. This stone is the house of God. We are his family. This house has been restored in ways that we never thought of. He's using each and every one of you. He's restoring that broken heart. He's restoring the devastating event that happened in your life. He's restoring and reminding you who you are, his child, and he wants the best. Yes, this message is short, but he's given us a song, and this song I want you to listen closely to. You probably have heard it. And then I'll tell you what's going to happen next.
Some may say it's hopeless, they must have never met my God. Some may say it's over, but it was finished on the cross. Some may say it's broken, but the healer's in the room. Some may say it's hopeless, but I know God's about to move. God's about to move. There's a miracle in the works. I can feel. There's revival in the church.
Showed me with this song, and he gave it to the composer, the musicians, the person that's singing. One of them was also going through a hard time, and that's where the words came from. He put it in that person's heart, and that's how the song came to be. So he's singing it for others. It is for you and I. And the Lord showed me, as this house is being restored with his strength and beauty, it is all about the Lord. It is all about the Lord. And now he's inviting you. There's going to be an altar call. Regardless if it's prayer or prophesying, it will be led of the Holy Spirit. And as a reminder, prophesying is to encourage, to edify, to build up the church. And as I come to you, I will let you know if it's prayer or if it's prophesying, because the word will be from the Lord. I will also use the prayer shawl. The prayer shawl is a symbolic item, just like the laying of hands when you pray, or using the oil when you pray. That's all it is. It is symbolic. In the Old Testament, the Lord showed me scarves and handkerchiefs and aprons were used. Even the hem, touching the hem of Jesus, was used. But he said in modern times, he's brought it up to modern times, and it is now called the prayer shawl. Oh yes, the handkerchief can still be used. The face towel can be used. It is all of him. And with his anointing, we are going to have this altar call. He is showing me already in the spirit realm, in this area, he shows me a door. He invites you in. And the door is covered in his holiness, his anointing. All I see is gold. So what happens when you enter a door of gold? Wouldn't the altar be of gold? Wouldn't you want some gold dust of his anointing on you? He's calling you. Don't be afraid. It's all about him. The first two people I'm going to speak with before, as everyone lines up or whoever wants to come to the altar, is Pastor Derek and Christy. Of course, the Lord says, why not the head? Start with the head. How precious they are to each and every one of us. So, most of the time, I might not be holding the microphones because they'll be personal to each of you. But since they're the head, he wants everyone to know. So we'll start with Christy. The Lord shows me not only how sincere and concerned you are, not just with your family, but because of where you are, where he's positioned you in the school. And he shows me that even with the school staff, they are noticing this compassion and love you have for them, as well as for the students. He shows me he's going to give you more wisdom and more knowledge, so you would know what to do in certain, I'm going to say in certain events, okay? He will always have you surrounded by your angels, guardian and warrior angels, to do their work as unto him. But he also knows you are very sensitive. So sensitive that even when someone comes talk to you in the office and when they leave, your tears are still there. Because of whatever happened in a situation with a child or with a teacher or with even custodians, he shows me you are there. And he will make you stronger, and he's going to show you how. He's going to give you the knowledge in Jesus' name. He's going to show you compassion, more, a deeper compassion for the people. And he says, as unto you, as unto your husband, Pastor Derek, that you will always be united. Maybe some things you don't understand, but you will be united in things of decision making. Because when you're better, he's better. When you're stronger, he's stronger. Vice versa, right? So in the name of Jesus, all honor and glory to the Lord, because it will always be all about him. He thanks you for your service. He thanks you for the feet of path you're going to walk in this newness in the school. You will walk, and the Holy Spirit will lead you. all those who don't know Jesus actually will start to see you. They will notice, even though when you've been there all along, right? They will notice more. They're going to know more. In Jesus' name, all honor and glory to the Lord. I thank him for Christy. I thank him. In the name of Jesus, we're going to move on to Pastor Derek. I am holding Christy's hand because things can trickle. He is showing me this trickleness. More of a new wave of strength, a new wave, so it's going to trickle, a new wave of an anointing. The community is waiting for you, Pastor Derek. The steps are coming to not only get closer, but even to strive in those steps. He shows me you're walking, and these giant steps you're taking is because he's telling you to get to know not every person, but every leader. He wants you to know the leaders in Waco, Texas. He wants you to know the leaders in Hewitt, Texas. He wants you to know the leaders in Belmead. He's going to spread you out. And in Jesus' mighty name, this fire that's burning in your stomach, the Holy Spirit, he showed me it's going to just raise up. It's going to spread out. It's going to be such an anointing that when people see you and hear you, they're going to hear the voice of the Lord through you. He also says, don't worry about your children. They're calling. He's calling them. He's going to call them to a place where they're going to come to you and say, I heard the Lord. I heard him. He's calling me, and I need advice. Why not come to you for advice? Because of the things that they're already experiencing, it's going to have to overtake. They're going to have to put God first. So why not come to the man of God, their father? So in Jesus' mighty name, I ask that not only you allow me to do this, it is of the Lord, okay? So what he's going to do is open your spiritual ears more. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. For his people, for this education area, for your neighborhood, and most importantly, your children, for generations to come. So be it, says the Lord. Amen and amen.